Jones album was out and we were talking about the next things, and we agreed, like, we have to sign Chet Faker and Jaguar Ma. Those felt like the next two to, like, propel what we were doing into a different space.
And talk is cheap, my darling, when you're feeling right at home. I wanna make you move with confidence. I wanna be with you alone. So help me help you start it. You're too comfortable to know. You're throwing out those words, no, you gotta feel it on your own.
Super scared about signing Chet. We'd never operated at that level before, but there was also a feeling at the time of like, fuck, we can do this. Like, that creates the platform to take things to a higher or a different level.
You gotta know, I'm feeling love, made it go. I'll never love another one, another you. It's gotta be love, I said it.
Built on Glass, that album was a huge success. Talk is Cheap won the Hottest 100.
This is number one.
I've got a big dumb smile on my face. It was a really awesome time. It was after the Arias and everything, so a lot had happened. Still, the Hottest 100 was one of those real kind of People's Choice Awards, I guess, which means more to us.
You don't know about what the things are that are going to be the big things at the time. Like, for instance, when we signed Flume or when we signed Chet Faker, it wasn't like we were like, these guys are going to win Arias, they're going to do huge tours, they're going to win the Hottest 100 or things like that. I guess you kind of just, you get the music or you work with the artist and you try to just support their idea.
Thank you so much. Take it easy.
Future Classic is obviously a record label, but is also a management company. They also are a publishing company. They're a touring company. It's a very punk label ethos where it's always their time and their energy and their money on the line.
You know, 10 years ago, if you said to me, you should be managed by your record label, I would say that is the fucking craziest thing I've ever heard. But I think in today, it's not that crazy. Like, the songs are just a business card to do gigs.
They're all different. All of the artists that we have sort of different ways of working and sort of different sort of levels of support that they want or need. Some of them are very trusting and hands-off. And then, of course, there's other artists who are extremely like, this is exactly how this is going to be.
The label's great for me because of the people on it. So you've got the Flumes, Chet Faker, Flight Facilities. It's like a big brother, like, doing better than you, and you're just like, no, I need to get there too. So you just keep pushing yourself to the next level.
I'm a big believer that you have to be candid with artists, and that's a difficult process to be candid but also nurturing.
He's always calling me up, like, late at night. I'm like, hey, I've got this idea. Why don't we, like, do this, and then we'll do this song and then link it with this thing and then make this whole big... And he's got these, like, big picture ideas, which is really cool.
That's the bit that, like, I love.
Yeah, you get so excited about that. The strategy.
It's like the strategy is my thing.
I think that we would be the most annoying people to be, like,
I think
pushing forward. We do what we want.
Reflectively.
We do it when we want.
Yeah.
And we have a vision for ourselves, and we've always had the same vision.
From our side, we can't write music. We maybe can say what we think of it and can be honest with what we think, but as soon as we're trying to write the music, it's gonna suck.
I haven't started yet.
Oh, it's all right.
These are just, I just gotta get it all working.
And then you gotta pack them all up.
Yeah.
Nathan got in contact with me. I barely knew him at that point, but he was obviously sort of following my work as a producer, and he sort of revealed that they were starting to work with bands and work with indie acts. And that was when our relationship first began. Came in here when we were playing them the new record. I think there was a moment in one of the songs where it just kind of breaks down to just this chord progression, this synth, and Chad just turned around and hugged me at that moment, and then I think Nathan got involved too, and it's just like, you know, that's what you want. You want them to feel like they love your music.
Johnny Future Classic was primarily about having like a new field, you know, and working with new people. People that had a certain vision about things that weren't to do with what we'd done in the past. I want another girl. I want another girl. I thought that you should know. There's no confusion, you know, between what they want to achieve and the artist they sign. It's kind of all guided towards one thing. It's a pretty easy realm to operate in as an artist because you know what they want and we know what we want. It kind of coincides in a way.
I guess it's always got to start with a particular type of taste and a real voice in terms of the artist they've collected. But then obviously what comes with that is a whole world that you build around that. Before Future Classic, I think another good example of it was an Australian label like Modular that also had that amazing ability to come out with a visual language and a musical language that was very unique and really stood on its own.
When the first releases came out, they were just gorgeous. I was just looking at these 12 inches, kind of going, wow, there's so much thought and attention to detail that's gone into these. You know, Jay's art direction is sort of so self-confident that it doesn't have to kind of shout.
Everything they release, you know, the sleeve will be really nice, or they'll have some special merch item, or everything's, it's really simple. It's kind of less is more approach, but it's also fun and creative.
I think Future Classic has an amazing aesthetic and always has, and it's a brand that they've curated really amazingly and with great attention to detail, and that's, I think, largely driven by Jay.
Oh really? I wouldn't be able to tell.
I kind of see myself as sometimes the translator between the artist, as in the musical artist, and the visual artist. Sometimes it's good to have a middleman who can kind of speak both their languages. Kind of just love working with different creatives and getting as many people involved as we can.
Wow.
I upped the grain a little bit.
But you didn't change the blacks?
I didn't change the blacks.
Wow.
But that's the paper as well.
I gotta send a photo to them.
I'm definitely a bead maker or a producer. The photography has become a big part of my life in the last year or so. I've never been one to be shy about my work or a perfectionist of sorts. If it's ready, I'll just chuck it out. Colorblind, so I can't see a lot of colors. Everything's quite desaturated in itself. I can't see purples, pinks, yellows, some oranges. So that's kind of my style, I think.
I think when you walk into an art gallery, you're very aware you're about to have an artistic experience. When you walk in and take your seat in the theater, you're very aware it's an artistic moment. Whereas maybe when you turn on the radio, it isn't framed in that way. And yet contemporary music is art, and often it just needs to be given a platform and a frame around it.
C'est CK were involved in the Fact magazine Sounds at the Sydney Opera House remix series.
George from the band recorded some sounds from the Opera House, quite bleak sounds, but really interesting.
Like, we just kind of like stuck our microphone into any room and crevice which we could find, really, just went and got as much sound as possible. So we spent like 8 hours just holding a microphone up to different things and seeing what happened. We got Australian Ballet in a rehearsal. We got, you know, like all these machine rooms downstairs, like underneath the house, which made all these bizarre sounds, and went and recorded organs and piano tunings. All of those sounds were then taken and then remixed or, you know, repurposed into a piece of music. So yeah, it was a really, really, really great experience. And Charles Murdoch did one, then we did one as well, which was, you know, was all right.
Welcome aboard, ladies and gentlemen. We ask that you move about the cabin as much as possible. And remember, all our flights are fitted with smoke detectors.
Celebrating our 10-year anniversary tonight and last night here at the Sydney Opera House. At first we thought it might be a bit corny, but having done it, it feels like something that's been worth doing.
The basic idea, I guess, was just to try to get as many of our guys at one event and just sort of, you know, have a great party.
Tonight solidified it for me.
Yeah, for sure.
That was like, you come back and you see Nathan, you see Harley going on stage as we're walking off stage. It, just everyone who was there, yeah. Tonight was the night, I think, in all the years that they've been together, that it's felt more like a family than ever before.
I would describe it as a family for sure.
Family.
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 I feel like that's such a key word, family vibe.
Use some other word.
I like family vibe.
This is the Future Classic family right here. These are the guys that made this possible.
They're kind of shy. Make them feel welcome.
Make them feel welcome. Come on. Woo!
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sydney Opera House, Vivid, you guys. You made our day.
Future Classic!